Okay, so welcome to lecture two of this four-part series on quantum techniques for stochastic mechanics. So today, what I'd like to do is just kind of remind everybody what the big picture is here, okay? So we all are very familiar with quantum mechanics, and we also are familiar with the idea that things can happen with some probability. Okay, so probabilistic mechanics or stochastic mechanics is something that we've all been familiar with our entire lives. So we should have some intuition for that. Now, when you learn quantum mechanics, and perhaps it's an unfortunate thing, or perhaps I'm just jaded because I did all of this work, but when you learn quantum mechanics, suddenly you go into this physics classroom, and maybe your past experience has been looking at Maxwell's equations or Newtonian dynamics, and suddenly someone throws in a complex number, okay, and you have these amplitudes, right? Now, it's a little bit unsettling, actually, right? It kind of just drops out of nowhere. So what I think is missing, all right, in at least the education of quantum mechanics is kind of the buildup that we're going to go through today, where you take a stochastic theory of mechanics and you make it look as much like quantum mechanics as possible. And actually, I think it's the best way to look at stochastic mechanics, what we're about to show. And then what you say is these small little changes in this theory give rise to quantum mechanics. Now, to justify the physics behind these changes, this is another issue, which is an open problem that we're all facing. Okay, where does quantum mechanics come from? And all these different questions. So today what I want to talk about is I want to talk about probabilities versus amplitudes. You have amplitudes and you have probabilities. Why are they different? How are they different? How are they the same? We want to talk about operators, okay? So operators in quantum theory and operators in stochastic theory. And I want to tell you about amoeba field theory, okay? So what's an amoeba? They're these strange things, which I don't know much about, actually. All I know is that they split into two, okay? And if you have too many of them, they start to compete. Okay, so there's a way to model these with a Petri net, which we talked about last time, and it's a logistic equation. And then at the end, I'll talk about stochastic mechanics versus quantum mechanics, and I'll set up some of the ideas for us to take over on Tuesday next week. Okay, so the master equation versus the rate equation. So given a stochastic Petri net, and please go ahead and pick up a couple of the handouts. So we'll talk about those today. So this way you don't have to print out the whole book. But the book is available. Has everybody that's wanted to look at that found it okay? Should be, if you go to my webpage or some webpage, it should be out there somewhere. So the book is the same title as the course if you're searching. So a stochastic Petri net, it has K species. And Xi is the concentration of the ith species. So what do we want to know? Okay, just like in quantum mechanics, we want to know how this quantity changes in time. So the right-hand side of this is going to be a sum of terms. And it's going to be one term for each transition in the Petri net. So if there was only one transition that we're dealing with, we end up with the rate of change of the concentration of the ith species to be equal to some rate constant times ni minus mi times this concentration vector of inputs. So what does this mean? It means to go into one transition that's a possible scenario for a given Petri net, you have some inputs. Okay, so some number of this X go in and some number comes out. Okay, and this is the input concentration for whatever it takes. So if one rabbit and one wolf go together to make this transition, then you put in an R times a W. Now, to use index-free notation, we introduce a vector where these are concentrations. So those are some positive numbers. Then we have an input vector. And these are natural numbers. k of them. You have an output vector. Which is, again, a natural number. And just to be cute, we can use this notation to mean precisely this. Then it becomes simple to write this. We have d of x, which is now a vector, of dt is equal to r n minus m x to the m. Okay, if you sum over all transitions, that gives you the complete equation of motion for the average concentration. So this is a mean field solution. It's not a master equation. Okay, so to write this out in a different way, to summarize, you say that T is the set of transitions. So tau is in T, it's one transition, and d of x of dt is equal to a summation over t in tau and t, r of tau, n of tau, so outputs minus the inputs, multiplied by the concentration of the inputs to make that reaction. So the example that we'll do, this is rabbits. And this is a transition with rate beta. It takes one rabbit in, and it produces two rabbits. So everybody knows that real rabbits don't produce asexually, but this model gives good predictions to real rabbit populations in the mean field. So this is birth. So what does this describe? Okay, so you have rabbits and you have wolves. Space doesn't matter in this model. So these rabbits and wolves have some equal likelihood of running into each other. Rabbits can spontaneously double. Okay, and when a rabbit and a wolf meet each other, the wolf eats the rabbit and then the wolf doubles. So you can think of it as biomass or something else. You don't have to necessarily, there's many different ways to use these to model things. However, the wolves die with some rate. Okay, so in this approximation, the rabbits live forever because the wolves eat them much quicker than they can die, but eventually the wolves disappear. So you have really different behaviors. You could also put a model like this, which we'll do next week. You can put these types of models on a lattice. So for instance, last time we had Nathan sitting next to Chris. Okay, so Nathan was in the infected state. Okay, yeah, he still is. So he's in state I, all right? Now there's a probability, they're sitting next to each other, so there's a coupling between them, okay? And they're spin one particles. You could be infected, susceptible, or recovered, okay? And Chris was actually in the susceptible state, right? Now, the probability vector is you have some probability, P, that, you know, Chris goes away uninfected, okay? Which is what I think happened, I hope, right? Okay, then there's another probability that he became infected. Okay, so that's kind of, you know, that's a model with space, but this model doesn't have that. So this is what we're doing here. Now from that, we can use this prescription to write down the averages of what's happening here. Okay, now in a real situation, maybe the averages are not important, but in many situations they are. That's what you want to know. You want to know the expected number of rabbits at time t and the expected number of wolves given some initial values. So to do that, I'll call r of t the number of rabbits at time t. I'll take the derivative, okay? And I have one transition beta. How many rabbits go in is one, and two come out. So it's two minus one, okay? And it's just an r here. Plus this transition now, which is an alpha, you have zero rabbits out, takes one rabbit in, and you have a rabbit times a wolf. Okay, that makes sense, right? You have a product. So whenever you have a product of a rabbit and a wolf, the rabbits go down, okay? But the rabbits can somehow go up with rate beta, which is the birth rate. So now if I look at the rate of change of the wolves at time t, so this transition, well, but they're not involved in that one. So this transition, gamma, takes two wolves out, one wolf in, and you have a W and an R. So these guys are going to go up by one proportional to the product of the number of wolves and the number of rabbits with the constant gamma. And they're going to have a delta, which spits out zero but takes one wolf in. And that's proportional to the number of living wolves. So that's it. Those are the mean field equations. Okay, so this is fun. And now we're going to talk about the master equation, which looks more like what we're talking about with quantum physics, because in the master equation, you're going to have a sum over all the different possible scenarios that could have happened, okay? Which is similar to a wave function, except now it's probabilities. So the thing that I need you guys to help out with is when you see this stuff, try to think about redoing something you know from quantum information theory using this language, or maybe think of a new idea altogether. It's kind of fun. Actually, it makes a good test bed for different ideas. So the master equation. All right, so I let psi of n1 to nk, I want this to be the probability that we have n1, some number of n1 things, to nk. Okay, so that's a probability. And the master equation is going to talk about how these coefficients change with time. Okay, so it contains all possible histories. So a philosopher of physics might say that it's a mosaic. Okay, they talk about the mosaic of the universe, which is all possible different paths. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit later about the amoeba mosaic, okay, when we do amoeba field theory. Okay, so now I have this vector n, which is n1 to nk. And these are again in the natural numbers, obviously. And we're going to cook up a formal power series. And then any state can be written as a sum over all these possible configurations like this. Okay, so now we can actually, to integrate here and to get your probability, you just set z equals to 1. Okay, so if I take this psi and I set my z equal to 1, then I'm going to end up with a summation over n, psi n, and if it's a valid state in a stochastic system, then this goes to 1. Okay, so what's the simplest example of a state? The simplest example of a state is going to be a monomial where we're 100% sure. So this is a pure state in a stochastic system. We're 100% sure that we have some state. We have this state, which is a pure state. We have z1, n1, up to zk, nk. So we'll see more examples of that. Now, given some state psi of t, how does it change with time? So the way that it changes with time is just like that. So there's some operator h, which lets us know how that's going to change with time. And the question is, well, what is h? So that's kind of the point of today, and we talked a little bit about it last time. So h is going to be built from creation and annihilation operators, okay? And these are going to act on these formal variables that we introduced before. So the ai, which is an annihilation operator, it's just defined by taking a derivative with respect to zi. Okay, and then your creation operator, is defined as multiplication by z. And so, again, you have the rate constant, you have the input vectors for each transition, and you have, or the output vectors, and you have the input vectors for each transition. Okay? Then, following this prescription, you end up with a Hamiltonian operator. Now, in the book, John Baez went through and he painfully justified all of this. So this guy's built physical theories his whole life, everything from gravity theories to spin foams, all that. So he knows how to do every single little bit of that. I learned a lot going through that process with him. And in the book, it goes through a lot of that. But because that's in the book and it's explained extremely clearly, what I want to convey in this short course, because it's four lessons, is just sort of the conceptual side of this to give everybody an understanding of how to go home and just write all this stuff down. Okay, and then this way, for most of the quantum physics that you're dealing with in the labs, okay, most of it actually is going to have some kind of analog. You can write down an operator that actually give rise to a stochastic process. And I'm trying to compare those and just think about them. And so that's kind of the approach that I'm taking here. It's a little bit more about sort of the physics behind this. And so from all that, you can say that H, your Hamiltonian operator, is a sum over all the transitions of your Petri net. Each one has a rate constant. There's going to be a creation operator using this funny notation here, minus okay. Now here, a to the m of tau means a1 m1 of tau. And of course, likewise, a plus and so how can we understand each of the terms in this equation? Because that's really the important part, is how can we justify what's happening here? Why is that a valid Hamiltonian for stochastic mechanics? Okay, so the first term . So this just describes how you have an input, which is annihilated, and you go to an output, which is created. Because remember, the M is the input. So that gets destroyed, then you create N of these. Those go up by one. Okay. The other term is a little bit trickier to understand, but not too much. Okay, so you have a subtraction sign, and you have, this is an input, and that's an input. So that's a number operator with the number of things in your input. And the way to understand that is, as you go forward in time, the chance of nothing happening goes down, okay? And you need this to make sure that all the probabilities sum to one. Okay, so now returning to this scenario here, I'm now going to write down my state, and I'll do this in green. I think maybe I'll just erase those and just leave the first part. So now we'll write down the master equation for this example. So you say psi is now a summation over n, psi n, zn. Okay. Now here zn is equal to sum z1 n1 z2 n2. And this is rabbits, and this is wolves. And so psi n . That's the probability of there being n1 rabbits and n2 wolves at some time as it evolves. Okay? So the probabilities evolve according to the master equation, which is psi dot of t equals h psi of t. Now this h is given by some beta times a term b plus a gamma times a term c delta times d. Okay, so that's what we'd expect, but we can stare at it just for 1 minute. It's exactly what we'd expect from this scenario, which we already did for the mean field approach. So you have beta, you have one transition there, so we're going to end up with a term in the Hamiltonian. Okay, you have predation, so you end up with a term C, some creation annihilation operators, and you get this term gamma. And then you have this death rate over here. Okay, so what's the difference between this equation and a quantum Hamiltonian. Well, okay, this thing has a death rate to it. You know, it's not a conservative system anymore. This is going to decay or something else. It's not necessarily going to model a reversible process. Now, there's a prescription, which is going to get me all those terms B, C, and D. M of tau 1. Okay, so let me label this tau 1. This will be tau 2. And this is tau 3. Those are transitions. So the M of tau 1, this is my input vector. Rabbits, wolves, comma. Okay, so for tau 1, this first one, one rabbit goes in, zero wolves go in, right? Okay, so then you have an output vector also. Okay, two rabbits go out, zero wolves come out. Okay, now I have enough information to determine the B down here. So the B is equal now to, I have to take my N here, which is going to be A1, the 1 is for the rabbits, plus A1 plus, because I get two of them there, so there's a 2 up there. So you square it, okay? Minus, now I'm going to deal with the M part here, minus A1 plus, and then I put another M in there, which is A1, no plus, okay? And that B goes into there for that Hamiltonian term. Now I'm going to similarly determine the other ones, okay? So what does this do? Well, the number operator, this is the number operator, of the rabbits is going to be subtracted off. Then you have this chance here of one rabbit being destroyed and two being created using the creation and annihilation operators. So it's pretty nice, I think, anyway. Okay, so for the second transition, it's a little bit more complicated because now it takes, as an input, one rabbit and one wolf, okay? And so for the output, it produces zero rabbits and two wolves. Okay, and then this gives rise to a C, okay? A2 dagger, A2 dagger, minus A1 dagger, A2 dagger, and then this is A1, A2. Okay, so one rabbit and one wolf can be destroyed, okay? And two wolves can be created, all right? But you have to subtract off the number operator of that thing, just to keep all the probabilities to sum to one. And then finally, as the last one, you have M, tau 3, rabbits 0, wolves 1, N of tau 3, rabbits 0, wolves 0. Okay, so that right there is going to give you your D. And we're going to have 1 minus A2 so this gives a number operator, and then you have an A2 destruction operator, so the wolves go down. All right, so that's the full show. That's a comparison between the average equations, these rate equations, and now the master equation. So this master equation is really quite nice because the Hamiltonian is going to act as an exponential operator. So you have, just like quantum physics, you have all these different transitions happening. You could have, a wolf being eaten by a rabbit, or you could have a rabbit splitting into two, one being eaten, then a wolf splitting into two, and you have all these different transitions as the Hamiltonian acts some number of times, like a path sum approach, okay? So are there any questions about that? I think it's pretty fun. It's fun, right? Yeah, so I like it because now I can do, I can now model wolves and rabbits with quantum physics, and I couldn't do that before, so that's why I think it's fun. So really, this course is a type of quantum technology. So is quantum physics and quantum computing? All right, so even if we don't have quantum computers, there's a lot of things that quantum physics and quantum computing is doing for the world. So as, for instance, other countries are now copying IQC, And I don't want to name which companies are copying them on camera, well, whatever. So I went to, you know, Beijing, and now there's one in Africa. They're building one of these in Brazil. And so this place has done so incredibly well within 10 years. It's a crazy idea to build an entire institute about quantum physics. Okay, but it did so well that now other people in other countries can go to the government and say, look at this IQC, let's make one of these. Now you ask yourself, well, what is a quantum technology? There's many different things out there, okay, lasers, transistors, etc. But another type of quantum technology is to use these quantum techniques which deal with the inherent complexity of the quantum model. So I can use these techniques now for another field. Now this is emerging, obviously. We're not able to go and hit like complex systems with the quantum hammer yet and really do something they're not doing. But this is an emerging quantum technology, just like other quantum technologies. At least that's how I look at it. So this is part of the picture of how quantum physics is influencing, you know, a number of different disciplines. Even though the notation is maybe, you know, we could do a little bit better there, it's far better than the notation of other fields, actually. It's far more consistent and unified. So that's my own personal viewpoint, but, and I'd love to hear yours. So probability versus quantum theory. So X is a set of states. In a probabilistic model, okay, I'll call it probabilistic model, a system has a probability psi of X to be in configuration X in X. Okay? And for this to be a valid state, you sum over the entire set X, and your psi of X should equal 1. Okay? In a quantum model, we instead say that a system has an amplitude. Okay, it's not a probability anymore. And so the amplitude of X in X now satisfies that. So in the probabilistic model, your state psi is a map from the set X to the real numbers. Okay? In such that psi is greater than or equal to 0, that means all the entry-wise elements of psi are greater than or equal to 0. These things integrate over that set X. You can turn this into a measure space. You can do integrals. That'll be 1. And this is a probability distribution. Okay, so that, now in the quantum model, your states are maps from the set X into the complex numbers. Okay, now the states are not probability distributions, but they're wave functions. So in the probabilistic model, you have L1 functions. And in the quantum model, you have the L2 functions. Okay, so comparing things in this way, we can sort of look at the difference between quantum mechanics and stochastic mechanics, and it starts to look more, you know, more similar, at least in terms of how to write down the theory, but they're, you know, they're very different in terms of the actual physics that you get out, right? By these very, you know, it seems very innocuous and it seems very small, but the physics is completely different in often many cases. So the integrals in the L1 theory, these produce real numbers, okay, as the probabilities do in this theory, but you take 2 of them in the L2 theory and only 1 normally. Okay, so the symmetries of stochastic mechanics. Okay, so what is a symmetry of a theory? It's an evolution that takes a valid state in that theory to another valid state in that theory. So we are used to, in quantum physics, we have isometries. We're usually interested in the invertible isometries, which are unitary maps, okay? In stochastic mechanics, you end up with Markov matrices. So in stochastic mechanics, I end up with U, some map, sending L1 to L1. Okay, which means that if I have a valid stochastic state, that the probability doesn't change if I act on it with U, which is what you'd expect also in quantum physics. So that's a symmetry of the theory. And obviously, if the state is positive, then acting on it with U will also be positive. The Markov matrices have non-negative real entries. Now, in quantum mechanics, you obviously have something, you have your maps that preserve this L2. And these maps are such that U psi U phi equals and so reversible implies unitarity. And so in probabilistic mechanics, I have d dt psi of t equals h psi of t. Later on next week, we'll talk about what it means to be time symmetric. So most of our quantum physics that we're dealing with actually all the time, we don't even know, we're actually working in a time symmetric sector. Okay? And time symmetry in stochastic mechanics is very, very subtle. In general, you don't have time symmetry at all. But in equilibrium, now everybody's like, well, nothing happens in equilibrium, but stuff does actually happen. There's a very subtle and a really tricky way that people thought of to do time symmetry in stochastic mechanics, okay, for Markov chains. And it's really, really subtle to compare that to quantum physics. And it turns out that time asymmetry, okay, I'll show you guys some processes at the end, and I'll have you guess using your intuition. And we'll see that all of us are actually very used to time symmetric quantum physics. And it'll be kind of fun. So this is, I think that's one of the cool applications of how this is set up. So psi of t is equal to e to the negative I t h psi of zero. Okay, so the moral of this is that here you have Hamiltonians, which are self-adjoint operators. This operator turns out to be something called infinitesimal stochastic. Okay? And there's a prescription of exactly how to get those and how those all work. Okay? And it's column sum to zero and its off-diagonal entries are non-negative. That's the rule for H to be a Markov matrix generator. And so that's pretty nice, I think. That's cool because it really now makes it look exactly like what we're familiar with. So now I'm going to switch gears a little bit, and I'm going to start to talk about equilibrium states. So most of these processes don't have equilibrium states, but there's a wide class of them that do. Equilibrium states are very, very important. And I'm going to go back, and I'm just going to show an example. First principle is going to be an amoeba example. Okay, what's going on here? All right, so amoebas. You can think of this as a logistic equation. It just models competition. So let's kind of think about what's going to go on here. Let's say, for instance, you go to a research institution that's brand new, okay? There's a huge building, nobody's there. You're one of the first people that get there. So what you do is you get like a huge team going in there, okay? Then suddenly, within 6 months, the place is completely filled up, all right? Then people start to compete, okay? Before, there's virgin territory. You just go and you just move people in. You know, this is how parasites spread, all right? Once the terrain is taken, then people start to compete. So this is what happens at first, okay? The number of amoebas goes up a lot, okay? One just starts splitting into two, okay? But as the number of pairs increases, okay, two of them start to compete and they go down. It's quite interesting. It's just a logistic model. Competition, the simplest way to model competition. And this is a logistic model. This actually works for many situations in the real world, some kind of approximation to this. So using our prescription, which we now know and love, we end up with summation over transitions of n minus m, x to the m. In this particular case, that's going to be equal to alpha 2 minus 1. Okay, so 2 going out, 1 in. Number of amoebas is, well, I used x, so I'll use x over here. And I have a beta. And so what you have is you have the number of amoebas is equal to alpha x going up, subtracted by beta x squared. All right, the solutions to this differential equation, they look like this. Okay, here I have some equilibrium. Okay, all of the solutions, all of the initial conditions that start down here, they all drive up this way. And all the ones down here, they all drive to here. Okay, so what's happening is there's stability in this model. Okay, so if I start off in an equilibrium state, I'm going to stay in an equilibrium state for all time. It doesn't change. It's constant. Okay, so that would be this number right here. I'm going to find that by setting this equation equal to 0. Okay, and you can solve for alpha and beta. That's going to give you some type of constant solution. Now, if the model's perturbed slightly or if you start off a little bit too high, you're going to have death. Okay, so if you have too many amoebas for the environment that you're in, some will die. Now, if you start off in an area where these amoebas can spread, they're going to grow, and then they're going to stabilize some number. Okay, this is an average number. All right, it's an expected number. Now, the important point is this model now has equilibrium, where the other models we're considering, they didn't have equilibrium. Okay, so now we'll do a master equation approach. Okay, so here then, the psi of t is a sum over n equals 0 to infinity of psi of n of t, zn. And we can find h using the method as before. You have alpha a plus, a minus a number operator, plus a beta, okay, then you start off with some initial configuration of amoebas, which is your initial population, you call it psi zero. You end up okay, so now I have this really strange type of equation. Okay, it's probabilities, and this helped me understand quantum physics a little bit better. So what's happening is every single power of h is acting, okay, and they're getting smaller as it goes up by 1 over k factorial. So what it's doing is giving every single possible configuration that could potentially take place. You know, this amoeba competes with this one, one dies. Okay, this amoeba competes with that one, another one dies. This amoeba splits into two, then competes, etc. Now, each one of these gives rise to some term. For instance, okay, I could have alpha beta over 2 times a dagger a. Okay, this is just some term that arises in the Hamiltonian. Okay, so I've expanded this out and I'm looking at this one particular term. I start off with two amoebas. Okay, that's my initial configuration, and here's what happens. Okay, so what happens is I start with two amoebas, they go in this way. Okay, one amoeba gets destroyed and it's split into two. Okay. Now, I take two amoebas here and destroy them, and I create one. Okay, so you have Feynman diagrams now for amoebas. Yeah, it's quite gruesome actually. But actually, it seems very strange. Like these amoebas are killing each other. But actually, it's better than the case of human beings. So. Muriato Musashi, the great Japanese swordsman, he said, your chance of survival of a sword fight is one-third. Okay, and he calculated this. He saw hundreds of these. It's one-third because what happens is a third of the time you win, a third of the time you lose, and the other third you both die. Okay, so the solution is to cheat, right? But these amoebas are competing honestly. So there's other examples of these Feynman diagrams on the book and on the blog. It's quite fun, actually. Okay, so now the equilibrium state, the eigenstates, like what you were talking about. Okay, before we conclude and just chat a little bit about what's going to go on next time. So next time, I think this is where what I would consider next week is where we're trying to do some stuff more like research. Coherent states. Who's familiar with coherent states? Everybody's seen a little bit of these, right? I think Nathan's actually written a lot of papers on these. I have, okay, some people in here might have. Chris, maybe you'll need these for your diamonds soon. He's doing NV centers. Okay, so a coherent state of the harmonic oscillator What these are is you want to minimize. You want to minimize this, making them both equal, and the minimal solution of that is a coherent state. And it turns out that legend, or at least Wikipedia, says that Erwin Schrödinger himself invented these when he was playing with the harmonic oscillator. So if you have enough time, you don't have television, and you're spending like rainy winters in England, I guess that's what you do. So for the harmonic oscillator, they'll write down some state that looks like this. It's not normalized, Cz, and that's equal to n equals 0 to infinity. Okay, so that's a coherent state. C is some complex number. And for the harmonic oscillator, you'll see that those exactly minimize that, subject to some constraints. Okay, and it's not normalized. Now, it turns out that for the amoebas, okay, there's a whole body of literature which for some reason, not completely, but for some reason, a lot of this stuff took place 20 years ago, and then it kind of stopped. It's kind of picking back up a little bit. And they worked out equilibrium suits, equilibrium conditions, and they have a deficiency 0 and deficiency 1 theorem. And none of this stuff was cast over into the language of field theory. And so this is, you know, one way to cast these tools back and forth. So a valid probability distribution for amoebas, okay, is equal to e to the cz over e to the c. Okay? And this is actually a Poisson distribution. All right? And you can go back and you can hit that thing with the Hamiltonian and you'll see what happens. Exactly. It is an eigenstate. All right? So that's quite interesting. That says if I start off in some equilibrium distribution, which is right here, which actually turns out to be some number c, if I start off there, I'll stay there forever. Okay? And you can calculate the expected number of amoebas using this. You put a number operator here, okay? In quantum physics, how would we do this? We'd integrate, we'd have psi bar a psi dx. In probabilistic theory, we have an n here, which is now a summation over a plus a psi, okay? Which is equal to summation over z times d dz e to the cz over e to the c. Okay, and you can see what's going to happen now. I have a summation over z, and I pull out a constant c times e to the cz over e to the c. Okay, this is going to now equal c times a summation over a plus psi. Okay, now remember, inside that psi is a formal variable z. So when I sum over it, it's just like taking an integral. So that goes back to c. Okay, so that's the expected value, and it gives an illustration of how to use a quantum technique for amoebas. All right, so I guess I'll conclude there right at the start of this part 20. So next time, here's what we'll talk about next time. So in quantum physics, it's a language of eigenstates, right? So you have a Hamiltonian, you can be in any eigenstate you like. All right, for stochastic mechanics, it's actually not the case. You can't be in all those eigenstates because most of them don't have the restriction for those states is you have to have, like what you were talking about, the restriction for the states is you have to have each coefficient be a real number. So if I have an eigenstate in quantum physics, I could have some complex numbers or negative numbers. Okay? In stochastic mechanics, you have this weird kind of thing that you shows up where it's almost like a reverse Pauli exclusion principle. So for a certain class of operators, which we call strongly connected Dirichlet operators, these things have a unique steady state solution. Okay? And there's a vector. One vector, which is an eigenstate, and it's an equilibrium state, just like this one, everything's going to go to that vector in stochastic mechanics. It has all non-negative entries, so it's a valid eigenstate, and that's the only valid eigenstate in stochastic mechanics. So either a stochastic system is in that eigenstate, or it's in a sum of at least two. And so the case is, for these stochastic operators, you end up with this really specific condition where you only get one valid eigenstate. So quantum mechanics and stochastic mechanics are painfully different. So let me show you one more thing, and we'll just to talk about like the conceptual, you know, you might have went in, you're living your life in symmetric quantum physics, okay? So time symmetric quantum physics. Let's see what happens here. Okay, three particles or three sites on a lattice. Okay, there's a hopping term on each one. All right, so you stick a particle in here. So let's talk about the stochastic case first. What's going to happen? Okay, stochastic mechanics, first time step, approximately you're going to jump. Then you're going to jump again. Then you're going to jump again. Okay, eventually it's going to go to the equal distribution, right? That's an equilibrium state for stochastic mechanics. Now let's talk about quantum mechanics. So these things, you have a symmetry here, right? It's a hopping Hamiltonian. Okay, so the probability here at all time must equal the probability there at all time. Because if the Hamiltonian carries that symmetry, the wave function must. Okay? And that's true if you're in time symmetric quantum mechanics. Okay? And so there's research that's ongoing right now that we're working with, and you'll see that that intuition actually breaks in time asymmetric quantum mechanics. And Chris and I are talking about this with David, hopefully, and other people. Zoltans and Boris will be here next week, and so we're talking about how to break that time symmetry and how to change these probabilities. And so in the equilibrium condition, we'll talk about time symmetry for Markov chains and Markov processes in equilibrium, and we'll talk about comparing that to quantum physics, and we'll also do this disease on a line. Okay, so now you can imagine you have a bunch of people lined up and you stick Nathan somewhere. Okay, and then the disease will propagate. Okay, so we'll do that. We'll do that next week. And please, we're not going to really do this experiment, but please also ask me, because I'm actually quite interested to know what you think about this. So far, there's basically been three people that have really messed with this stuff. John Baez kind of initiated this whole thing. I worked on it with him, and then Brendan Fong also did some work on this. And it's going to be really interesting to see what you guys have to say about this. So please let me know.